Hi, I'm Dr. Vyshnavi. If you're able to see me and listen to me, kindly give me a quick confirmation so that we can start the class. Okay, so I think the relay is fine and you all are able to listen to me and see me. So today we shall be discussing some clinical scenarios in ENT and we will have some clinical questions and extended matching type of questions in the end so that you get a quick idea of different clinical situations and the probable differential diagnosis so that it will help you to get to the answer very easily. So we will begin the class. So before we begin, for those all who do not know about what we have on offerings from Unacademy, we have the NEET PG category has a 20% off currently running on all subscriptions, and this is valid from June 27th to June 30th. You can use the code NEET PG10 to get the discount, or you can use my code, which is ENT Life, to get an additional 10% or 20% off, which is from 27th to 30th. If you want more details, there's a contact number mentioned here. You can take the details from there upon the plus batch course. Now on Unacademy, we have something called as a target NEET PG 2023 batch, which is a 6 months batch course. And this 6 months batch course will be sub-module 1 having a subject wise batch course, and module 2 which is going to have a high yield revision course. So we have all the top 19 educators who is going to teach you and get you prepared for the NEET PG 2023 examination. We have a test and discussion batch for repeaters, which started from July 1st. It is for 6 months, and the test and discussion will happen from July to October, and it's a 250-hour batch, and module 2 is a high yield theory batch, which is going to run from November to December. Now, iconic prizes. What is iconic subscription? Unacademy and Prep Ladder together is the iconic subscription. So those who would like to take the iconic subscription, the prices are increasing soon. So those interested can use again the code ENTLIFE to get a 10% off before the prices increase. So with this, we'll begin our class. During routine nasal endoscopy, a clinician asks the patient to swallow and the eustachian tubal orifices open. What is the innervation of the muscles that are responsible for this observation? The vagus nerve and the accessory nerve, the vagus nerve and the trigeminal nerve, the glossopharyngeal nerve and the vagus nerve, the hypoglossal nerve and the glossopharyngeal nerve. So all those who are there online, can you please try to answer this in the chat box below? So I'm waiting for your answers. Sutharsun says one. What about others? All those who are on online, can you please try to answer it? Okay. So normally the eustachian tube is a collapsed structure. So this eustachian tube is normally collapsed, and there are two muscles which will help to open the eustachian tube. The two muscles which will help to open the eustachian tube are tensor veli palatini and levator veli palatini. These two are the openers of the eustachian tube. So if these are the two openers, then what is the innervation? Tensor veli palatini is supplied by the fifth nerve. It is the muscle of the first arch, so it is supplied by the fifth nerve. Levator veli palatini is supplied by the tenth nerve, the vagus nerve. So when the patient is swallowing and the eustachian tubal orifice is open, it means that these two muscles are acting, and hence the fifth nerve and tenth nerve are functional, which means that the innervation for the muscle is via the vagus nerve and the trigeminal nerve. So this is the correct answer to the question. So Sutharsun, Ardra, Abhilash and Angana, I hope you got the answer, which is 5th nerve and the 10th nerve. A patient with facial injuries is brought to the casualty with swelling of the upper lip and bleeding from the nose. There is malocclusion of and ecchymosis of the maxillary buccal sulcus. A CT scan of the facial bone shows bilateral transverse fracture passing through the maxilla above the level of teeth. Which of the following is consistent with the injury described? Leaflet 1 fracture, leaflet 2 fracture, leaflet 3 fracture or leaflet 4 fracture? So I'm waiting for your answers. All those who are live, please try to answer. Leaflet fracture or maxillary fracture is a very, very common entity. Please try to answer it. So they are telling you there is ecchymosis of the maxillary buccal sulcus. So maxilla and the buccal sulcus, there is ecchymosis, meaning the fracture line is running through floor of the nose and floor of the maxillary sinus, which is above the level of teeth. So which leaflet fracture has a fracture line running from the floor of the nose and floor of the teeth? Yes, it is consistent with leaflet 1 fracture. Okay, so this is consistent with leaflet 1 fracture. So in leaflet 1 fracture, you have a fracture running from the floor of the nose and floor of the maxillary sinus, and there is rupture of the greater palatine artery, which is why it is also called as Guerin's fracture. The bluish discoloration that you see on the palate is called as Guerin's sign, and the name of the fracture is called as Guerin's fracture. So there is swelling of the upper lip and bleeding from the nose. Malocclusion and ecchymosis of the maxillary buccal sulcus is suggestive of leaflet 1. Leaflet 2 is also called as pyramidal fracture. So in leaflet 2 fracture, what would you see? You would see fracture line going from the nasion, medial wall of the orbit, floor of the orbit and the maxilla. So it's like a pyramid. So pyramidal fracture is your leaflet 2 fracture. Leaflet 3 fracture is your craniofacial disjunction, where the cranial cavity is getting separated from the facial skeleton. It is called as craniofacial disjunction. That is your leaflet 3 fracture. So the one that has been described here is leaflet 1 fracture. A patient suffered facial trauma after a road traffic accident. He complains of nasal swelling and bleeding. On examination, there is a pinkish blue mass on either side of the septum. Which of the following is an acute complication of this condition if it is left untreated? Acute sinusitis, anosmia, dental abscess or saddle nose deformity. So I'll wait for you to answer. Okay, so I see Ardra, Elvis answering it as 4. What about others? I'll give you about 20 seconds. Please think over and answer very quickly. Abhilash says 1, Debashish Panda says 4. Okay, so there is a history of facial trauma after a road traffic accident. So if there is a history of trauma and there is nasal swelling and bleeding and there is a pinkish blue mass on either side of the septum, what is your diagnosis? Post-traumatic, if there is a pinkish blue mass on either side of the septum, it is suggestive of septal hematoma. Okay, so it is suggestive of septal hematoma. Now if a septal hematoma gets infected, what would it result in? It would result in a septal abscess. And if this abscess or infection spreads to the underlying septal cartilage, there will be necrosis of the cartilage. And when there is necrosis of the cartilage, what type of deformity? It would result in saddle nose deformity. One another important complication that could occur with septal abscess is cavernous sinus thrombosis, because this is in the dangerous area of face. Any infection in this area can spread retrograde to the cavernous sinus and cause a cavernous sinus thrombosis. So following septal hematoma and a septal abscess, you can expect to have a saddle nose deformity or a cavernous sinus thrombosis. So these are two important things that you must remember with septal hematoma. Hematoma and abscess will present with similar clinical features of nasal obstruction, difficulty in breathing. But the one that differentiates hematoma from abscess is the presence of fever, the presence of lymphadenopathy, and the presence of headache. So if there are these three clinical features, it is more in the favor of an abscess. But only pain in the root of the nose or dorsum of the nose, and there is difficulty in breathing with a bluish mass on either side of a septum, it is hematoma. But the same with fever, headache, and lymphadenopathy is suggestive of an abscess. Okay, let's go to the next question. A young man met with an accident leading to loss of hearing in the right ear. On otoscopic examination, the tympanic membrane was intact. Pure tone audiometry showed an airborne gap of 55 decibels on the right ear with normal cochlear reserve. Which of the following could be the probable tympanometric finding? Would you see a A type of graph, which is given in option A, an option B graph, an option C graph, or an option D graph? So which type of a graph would you expect following an accident where the tympanic membrane appears to be normal but there is an airborne gap of 55 decibel with a normal cochlear reserve? What is the inference from this entire clinical scenario that you're getting? I am waiting for your answers. Please answer in the chat box. So following an accident, if the tympanic membrane is normal, so there is no pathology in the tympanic membrane. They haven't mentioned any pathology in the external auditory canal, but they have mentioned that there is an airborne gap. How much is the airborne gap? It is 55 decibels. So if there is a 55 dB gap, what does it suggest to you? It suggests to you a conductive hearing loss. Now from the pinna till the foot plate of your stapes is your conductive pathway. So when they said pinna is normal, external auditory canal is normal, tympanic membrane is normal, then where is the pathology for causing this conductive hearing loss? It is in the middle ear. Now they are saying your tympanic membrane appears normal. So obviously behind the tympanic membrane, you're not expecting any blood to be there, because if hemotympanum or blood would be there in the middle ear following trauma, it would appear a bluish drum, which we are not seeing. Now what is the only possibility after trauma? There is a possibility that the ossicles may get discontinuous with each other. So there can be an ossicular discontinuity. So if there is an ossicular discontinuity, how would you identify that on a tympanometry? On a tympanometry, you will get a AD type of a graph. So if you see a graph which has a peak at zero, so you have an ascending curve, peak, and a descending curve. So the peak lies at zero, occupying half of the length on the y-axis. It is called as A. If you see the peak at zero, but it is not occupying half of the length on your y-axis, then you call it as AS. You will get this in otosclerosis. If you get a graph where there is no peak at all, or sometimes the peak is present more than half of the length on your y-axis, you call it as AD type of a graph, which is seen in ossicular discontinuity. If you get an ascending curve, descending curve, and the peak is at occupying half of the length on your y-axis, but it is not at zero, it is at negative pressure, like minus 100 or minus 200, you call it as a C type of a graph. And if you get a single flat line, it is called as a B type of a graph. So AD type of a graph is suggestive of ossicular discontinuity. So in the options given to you, The option D is showing you that there is discontinuous graph and the peak is not present. This is suggestive of an AD type, and AD type is seen in ossicular discontinuity that fits in this clinical situation. So now let's go to the next. I'm sorry for the discontinuity, there was a little bit of an issue, so I was just trying to sort it. So I hope it's better now. Are you all able to see me and listen to me now? Okay, so we were discussing about, yes, I am able to see your answers. Most of you have answered it as one. So following RTA, if there is clear mucus draining from the nose and there is loss of perception of smell, you are going to think about CSF rhinorrhea. So for CSF rhinorrhea, the most common site where the CSF rhinorrhea would occur would be from the cribriform plate of the ethmoid. So cribriform plate of the ethmoid is the most common site for CSF rhinorrhea to occur post-traumatic. So the likely site of injury that has resulted in these symptoms to cause clear mucus from the nose with loss of smell is because of the injury to the cribriform plate of the ethmoid. 74-year-old male presents with 2-month history of dysphagia and otalgia. After full workup, the patient was diagnosed with cancer of larynx and that has gone to the laryngopharynx. The clinician believes that the otalgia may be due to compression of a nerve by the tumor. What is the function of this nerve? Is it responsible for head turning, tongue movement, swallowing, taste and sensation from the posterior 1/3 of the tongue? So I think the tongue has got hidden in the image in my photograph box, so you can just, I have written it down, so for your convenience. I'm waiting for your answers in the chat box. Okay, so Pooja Gupta says D. What about others? Sutarsan says D. Okay, so the question says there is a patient with a 2-month history of dysphagia and there is otalgia. A full workup shows cancer of the larynx which has spread to the larynx. Now, what is the nerve supply of the larynx and the laryngopharynx? It is the vagus nerve. Whether it is the superior laryngeal nerve or the recurrent laryngeal nerve, it is the vagus nerve that is supplying the larynx. Now, can vagus cause referred otalgia to the ear? Yes. Via which nerve? Via the Arnold's nerve. Now, what is the function of the vagus nerve? Is it responsible for head turning? No. It is via the spinal accessory nerve. Tongue movement? It is via the hypoglossal nerve. Swallowing? It is again by the vagus nerve. But taste sensation from the posterior 1/3 of the tongue is via the glossopharyngeal nerve. So the function of the vagus nerve is responsible for swallowing. So swallowing is done by the vagus nerve. Taste sensation from the posterior 1/3 of the tongue is via the glossopharyngeal nerve. So I hope you got the answer. It is not 4, but it is 3. Clear to everyone? A male patient was diagnosed with squamous cell carcinoma of the nasal cavity. The patient's prognosis was determined using Lederman's classification. So the answer is 3, yes. Donya. Okay. A male patient was diagnosed with squamous cell carcinoma of the nasal cavity. The patient's prognosis was determined using Lederman's classification. According to this classification, which of the following may indicate a good prognosis? Alveolar process, maxillary part of the nose, ethmoid sinus, olfactory area of the nose. So can you answer in the chat box? Okay, Priya says A. I'm waiting for others to answer. Donya says B. Okay. So when we say Lederman's classification, we draw two vertical lines passing from the medial canthus of both the eyes, and we pass two horizontal lines, one passing through the floor of the orbit and the second passing through the floor of maxillary sinus. Lower the malignancy, better the prognosis. So if we have a alveolar process carcinoma, if we have the maxillary part of the nose carcinoma, if we have an ethmoid sinus carcinoma and an olfactory area carcinoma. So higher, the poorer the prognosis. So according to this classification, lowest is your alveolar carcinoma. So the best prognosis is alveolar process carcinoma. So Priya, you're right. I hope others understood this. So lower the malignancy, better the prognosis. So alveolar process carcinoma have a better prognosis as compared to higher malignancies. A female patient presented with decreased ability to smell. On examination, there is a large nasal cavity with foul smell coming from her nasal cavity. CBC showed microcytic anemia and serum vitamin D levels are low. What is the most likely organism causing her this disorder? Pseudomonas aeruginosa, Klebsiella oceana, Proteus mirabilis, Haemophilus influenza. This is very easy question, very common question which occurs very often in the examination. So female patient, decreased ability to smell, large nasal cavity with foul smell in the nose, CBC showing microcytic anemia and serum vitamin D levels are low. Yes. So all this is in favor of, can anybody tell me? It is atrophic rhinitis. And what is this atrophic rhinitis caused by? It is caused by Klebsiella oceana. Klebsiella oceana is also called as Peri's bacillus. Klebsiella rhinoscleromatis is called as Frisch bacillus. Klebsiella oceana is called as Peri's bacillus. And this Peri's bacillus is a gram-negative bacillus. So the organism responsible for causing atrophic rhinitis is Klebsiella oceana. A 20-year-old male presented with severe congestion inside the left side of nose. He had a history of recurrent congestion. He used over-the-table nasal decongestant drops every time. What should be done in this patient? Intranasal antihistamine, stronger nasal decongestant drop, intranasal corticosteroid, continue to use the decongestant spray. I'm waiting for your answers. Yes, I can see C coming as most common answer amongst the students. So when there is a patient with a history of severe nasal congestion and recurrent congestions, over the counter decongestants he has used, this diagnosis is directly in favor of a condition which we call it as rhinitis medicamentosa. So it is suggestive of rhinitis medicamentosa. So in this rhinitis medicamentosa, first and foremost, you have to discontinue the decongestant spray, not continue, but discontinue the nasal spray. You will not use any further stronger decongestants. You will give short course of intranasal steroids and systemic steroids. So a short course of intranasal and systemic steroids are given to upregulate the activity of the alpha adrenergic receptors, which have been downregulated because of chronic usage of this topical decongestants. So you will give intranasal corticosteroids. Okay, a male patient diagnosed with the following clinical finding. He was later diagnosed with a disorder after necessary investigation, which occurs due to hypertrophy of which of the following? Lacrimal gland, sebaceous gland, ceruminous glands, malignancy. Okay, I think the clinical picture is not clearly visible. So I'll tell you, the clinical picture is suggesting to you of rhinophyma. So can you tell me, rhinophyma occurs due to hypertrophy of which glands? Yes, Yukti, I think the clinical image is not seen, so I'm giving you the diagnosis. Yes, so rhinophyma, potato nose, occurs due to hypertrophy of? It is sebaceous glands. It is seen in patients with acne, rosacea or chronic diabetics. So it is a condition which you see because of hypertrophy of the sebaceous glands. So the clinical picture, I think it is hidden behind my screen. So the clinical picture suggesting to you of rhinophyma. A patient with a history of recurrent tonsillitis underwent a tonsillectomy. The patient presented with secondary hemorrhage post-tonsillectomy. When is this complication most commonly seen? 6 hours after surgery, 24 hours after surgery, 6 days after surgery, 14 days after surgery. So when we classify hemorrhage after tonsillectomy, intraoperative hemorrhage, what happens during surgery? Intraoperative hemorrhage is your primary hemorrhage. So what is primary hemorrhage? The hemorrhage that occurs during surgery is primary. Now any time after surgery but less than 24 hours, we call it as reactionary hemorrhage. So before 24 hours is reactionary hemorrhage. Anything beyond 24 hours up till 14 days, we call it as secondary hemorrhage. So here they are telling to you that, asking you the definition of secondary hemorrhage. So anything after 24 hours but below 14 days is secondary hemorrhage. 6 days after surgery also you will call it as secondary hemorrhage, but by definition we started after 24 hours, so we'll take it as 24 hours after surgery. Actually both B and C can be the right answers, but giving the thought process a little more reshaping our thought process, 24 hours would be more better option than taking 6 days. Primary hemorrhage commonly can occur through the peritonsillar vein or the tonsillar artery. Reactionary hemorrhage commonly occurs because of slipping of ligature. So there is a bleeder, you have ligated it, and after that there is slipping of ligature. It causes reactionary hemorrhage. Secondary hemorrhage commonly occurs due to infection. So whenever there is an infection, it will result in secondary hemorrhage. So these are the different types and causes for hemorrhage. 60-year-old female presented with hearing loss in the left ear, ipsilateral immobility of the soft palate and neuralgic pain of the left side of her face. Weber's and Rinne's tests were done, which concluded that the hearing loss is conductive. What is the most likely diagnosis? Lermoy syndrome, Trotter syndrome, Costin syndrome, Ortner syndrome. Yes, Priya, I'll just explain you Paradise criteria in a minute. Let us finish this MCQ. Okay, so most of you have answered it right. So when a patient is having hearing loss and they have told you hearing loss is conductive type, and they are telling you ipsilateral immobility of soft palate indicating that there is a 10th nerve involvement. Neuralgic pain on the left side of the face indicating you a 5th nerve involvement. So conductive hearing loss, 5th nerve involvement, 10th nerve involvement is suggestive of a syndrome which is called as Trotter syndrome or Trotter's triad. This Trotter's triad is seen in nasopharyngeal carcinoma. So Trotter's triad is a condition that you would see in NPC, which is your nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Lermoy syndrome is seen in, is a variant of Meniere's disease. Ortner syndrome is cardiovocal syndrome, where a left atrial hypertrophy compresses the recurrent laryngeal nerve, causing a change in voice. That is your Ortner syndrome. Okay, so Priya, hearing loss, whenever there is a nasopharyngeal carcinoma, it will result in unilateral serous otitis media and not bilateral serous otitis media. Unless the tumor has become so big that it is compressing the entire nasopharynx, then it will cause bilateral, but otherwise it will often result in a unilateral conductive type of hearing loss because of serous otitis media. Okay, so you were asking me about Paradise criteria for tonsillectomy. So in Paradise criteria, it is a criteria that you use for defining what is the meaning of recurrent tonsillitis. So what is the meaning of recurrent tonsillitis? Recurrent tonsillitis is, you can define by the number 753123. So if a patient has 7 or more episodes of tonsillar infection, evident by sore throat, fever, difficulty in swallowing, dysphagia, 7 or more such episodes if they happen in 1 year, or 5 or more episodes happening in 2 consecutive years, meaning this year there is an episode and again next year. So 5 or more episodes in 2 consecutive years and 3 or more episodes in 3 consecutive years. So if you have this, then you would define that the patient is having recurrent tonsillitis. So got it, Priya? What is Paradise criteria? Okay. TMJ dysfunction is your Costin syndrome. You are right. A patient presented with severe headache from the last 6 months. He also complains of tingling sensation all over his face. He reports he has had never any kind of trauma. MRI of the brain was taken, which is shown below. What is the most likely diagnosis? Okay, let me just put the MRI closer so that you can see the image. Yes, now you can answer this. I think you're able to see it. Yes, now Priya, I have changed the image. I hope I've got it to the center. I hope you're able to see it now. Yes, so if there is a patient with complaints of severe headache and there is tingling over the face, there is no history of any kind of trauma, MRI is showing you something very peculiar, which is an ice cream cone appearance. The ice cream cone appearance is suggestive of acoustic neuroma, which is also called as vestibular schwannoma. So acoustic neuroma, vestibular schwannoma mean one and the same. Okay, so this is very, very typical of acoustic neuroma. Medicine Hub, I don't think I can enlarge the image, but at least are you able to appreciate this tumor having an ice cream cone appearance? From the cerebellopontine angle, it is going to the compressing the cerebellum also. So I think this appearance itself is very specific or suggestive of acoustic neuroma. Okay, a patient presented with hoarseness of voice, dysphagia and numbness of the tongue. He was sent for an angiography, results of which were given below. The sign seen here in the image is a sign seen in which of the following? Carotid body tumor, Meniere's disease, lateral sinus thrombosis, Graves' disease. This is very typical sign. Can you tell me what is the name given to this sign where you see splaying of the carotid? This is your common carotid dividing into internal and external carotid, and there is splaying here. They are getting wide apart from each other because there is a tumor in between, which is originating from the glomus bodies. What is this called as? What is this sign? Yes, this is a carotid body tumor, but what is the name radiologically? What is the name given to this sign? Yes, very good, Berlin. It is called as Lyer sign, which is a splaying of the carotid is suggestive of a sign, which we call it as Lyer's sign. Very good. A 10-year-old boy accompanied by his mother presents with complaint of fever, sore throat, fatigue and difficulty in swallowing since the last 2 days. Past medical history is insignificant and there is no history of recent illness or travel. Vitals are suggestive of pulse rate being 105, blood pressure 98/60, respiratory rate is 20 and temperature is 102 degrees Fahrenheit. Physical examination reveals cervical lymphadenopathy and a red swollen tonsil. Which of the following can be late complications seen with this condition? Hepatic abscess, valvular heart disease, encephalitis, pancreatitis. So there is fever, there is sore throat, fatigue, difficulty in swallowing. What does it tell you? It tells you that in a 10-year-old boy, this child is having acute tonsillitis. Now, acute tonsillitis is commonly caused by which bacteria? It is most commonly caused by group A beta hemolytic bacteria. So it is caused by group A beta hemolytic streptococcus. This group A beta hemolytic streptococcus has a cross reactive antigen against the myocardium. So it can result in valvular heart disease. Other than that, it has got cross reactive antigen against the glomerulus. So it can result in glomerulonephritis and against the joint. So it can result in arthritis as well. So this is suggestive of valvular heart disease. Okay, so late complication can be heart disease, not encephalitis. Got it, medicine, huh? Okay. A emotional patient complains of being able to taste her own tear. So a emotional patient complains of being able to taste her own tears a few minutes after crying. Through which pathway does the tear drain into the nasal cavity? So through the nasolacrimal duct into the infundibulum of the middle meatus, to the inferior meatus, penopalatine foramen into the superior meatus, or to the hiatus semilunaris of the superior meatus. So I think all of you have answered 2, which is the right answer. So whenever you cry through the nasolacrimal duct, the tears get drained into the inferior meatus of the nose. So nasolacrimal duct drains into the inferior meatus. Where it drains into the inferior meatus, it is guarded by a valve which is called as valve of Hasner. Okay, so it is called as valve of Hasner. 65-year-old male patient presents to the emergency department with a 2 weeks history of purulent nasal discharge and facial pain. So there is a 2 weeks history of purulent nasal discharge and facial pain. There is mild maxillary tenderness noted bilaterally. He denies of nasal obstruction, changes in the sense of taste or smell, and no postnasal drip. Which of the following radiographic findings are consistent with the suspected diagnosis? Bony destruction of the maxillary sinus, air fluid level of the maxillary sinus, thinning of the sinus mucosa, linear fractures in the sinus. So Donia Zidan says 2. What about others? I am waiting for your answers. Priya, correct. It is suggestive of maxillary sinusitis. But what is it that you would see in a radiograph of a patient with maxillary sinusitis? Would you see bony destruction? Would you see air fluid level? Would you see thinning of the sinus mucosa? Would you see linear fractures? So whenever there is a sinusitis, there is an inflammation of the sinus wall. So there is inflammation. And because of inflammation, there is an exudate that is produced causing some fluid in the sinus. So there is an air level above and there is a fluid level below. So you will see that there is an air fluid level. But would you see in an acute sinusitis any bony destruction? No, there is no bony destruction, but you would see an air fluid level. Would you see thinning of the sinus mucosa or thickening of the sinus mucosa? So what you will see will be thickening of the sinus mucosa because of inflammation. So it's not thinning but thickening, and linear fractures would be seen following trauma. It will not be seen in sinusitis. Now we have extended matching type of question. So I have a theme which is ear discharge. Now we have different differential diagnosis that can result in ear discharge, like swimmer's ear, otomycosis, foreign body, cholesteatoma of the canal, cholesteatoma of the middle ear, mucosal or tubotympanic type of CSOM and acute otitis media. All of them will produce ear discharge. The clinical scenarios will be different. Now I'll give you clinical scenarios. You got to match the clinical scenario amongst the options given. Like the clinical scenario will change, options remain the same. So can you match a 50-year-old diabetic? He's a receptionist complaining of ear discharge, ear pain and burning sensation. Add a note, discharge is positive for Pseudomonas. So what could it be? Is it swimmer's ear, otomycosis, foreign body, cholesteatoma of the canal, cholesteatoma, mucosal type of CSOM or acute otitis media? So can you tell me this sort of a clinical situation would fit best for what diagnosis? So Priya says 1, Black Thunder says 7, Akanksha Sharma says 1, Saturusan says 7. What about others? Okay, so we call this as swimmer's ear, also called as telephonous ear. It is also called as diffuse otitis externa. These are all different names to the same condition. So when there is a receptionist, he is constantly taking phone calls, and when they take phone calls, there will be sweating in the canal. So when there is sweating in the canal, normally the canal pH is acidic. The wax that is there is acidic in pH. Now because of excessive sweating, the acidic pH becomes alkaline, and this alkaline pH will favor the growth of bacteria. So alkaline pH will favor the growth of bacteria, and hence there will be otitis externa. Again, diffuse otitis externa is commonly seen because of Pseudomonas. So this fits best for swimmer's ear, also called as telephonous ear. Yes, Priya Chauhan, Govindraj, it is suggestive of malignant otitis externa, diabetic, Pseudomonas. You must think about malignant otitis externa, but since that's not there in the options, can we go to the next best option, which is swimmer's ear or telephonous ear? Yes. A 50-year-old complaining of profuse ear discharge, which is non-foul smelling, non-blood stained, but it is associated with an upper respiratory tract infection, and this has been there since 10 years on and off. So can you match to the which clinical diagnosis it fits the best? I'm waiting for all of you to answer. Yes, so 50-year-old complaining of non-foul smelling, non-blood stained discharge, which increases with upper respiratory tract infection, is suggestive of a mucosal type or a tubotympanic type of a CSOM. Now, if there would be foul smelling blood stained discharge, then it would have been cholesteatoma. So here, since it is non-foul smelling, non-blood stained, we are going for tubotympanic, which has been labeled as mucosal type of CSOM. Why is it not acute otitis media, Black Thunder? Disease is there since 10 years. So when a disease is there since 10 years, can it be acute? It cannot be. It is a chronic otitis media. Since it's non-foul smelling and non-blood stained, tubotympanic or mucosal type of CSOM. 50-year-old diabetic presenting with primary complaint of itching, which is associated with discharge and pain. So where would you get primarily itching as a complaint? In which of these diseases? Akanksha says 2. Priya, we've already done the situation for 6, so it can't be 6. Black Thunder also says 2. Adra says 2. Yes, so this clinical situation, wherever you get itching, it is very, very specific of fungal infection. So this is suggestive of otomycosis. So otomycosis is a fungal infection, and fungal infections predominantly occur in uncontrolled diabetes. So this clinical situation where itching is the predominant feature fits in for otomycosis. 50-year-old with dull aching pain and foul smelling discharge. Examination shows defect and debris in the floor of the external auditory canal. Tympanic membrane is normal. Now what is it? Donia, it is cholesteatoma, but now is it a middle ear cholesteatoma or a canal cholesteatoma? They are saying there is a defect in the floor of the canal and there is debris in the floor of the canal. Tympanic membrane is normal. So is this a cholesteatoma of the external auditory canal or a cholesteatoma of the middle ear? It is a cholesteatoma of the external auditory canal. So you can see cholesteatoma, or you can say it is cholesteatoma because of the presence of defect, because of the presence of debris, because of the presence of foul smell. All of these are suggestive of cholesteatoma. Now let's go to the second theme, which is diagnosis of hearing loss. You have got different clinical situations like acute otitis media, acoustic neuroma, barotrauma, BPPV, mastoiditis, otosclerosis, ototoxicity, petrous bone fracture, Ramsey-Hunt syndrome, wax and cholesteatoma. These are the options which will remain the same. Please answer the correct relevant answer for this particular patient. 50-year-old man with complaints of poor hygiene and complaint of deafness every time after shower. So only after shower he has ear obstruction, otherwise he is not having. So what is the probable diagnosis here? So I'm waiting for your answers. So Donia, I'll repeat the question for you. 50-year-old, poor hygiene and deafness after shower. Options are acute otitis media, acoustic neuroma, barotrauma, benign paroxysmal positional vertigo, mastoiditis, otosclerosis, ototoxicity, petrous bone fracture, Ramsey-Hunt syndrome or wax. Yes, very clearly this is a suggestive of wax obstruction, because every time the patient is taking shower, water enters the ear, wax will swell up causing obstruction of the canal and deafness. So this poor hygiene again suggests that the patient is not doing oral toileting well, which is again suggestive of wax obstruction. Same options, 20-year-old man presents a head injury and some bruising on the side of the head with hearing loss. So there is a history of injury, bruising and hearing loss. So what does it suggest to you? Very easy. So whenever there is an injury, following that there is hearing loss, what will you think of? Will you think of infection? Will you think about tumor? Will you think about middle ear diseases like otosclerosis or mastoiditis? Or would you think of petrous bone fracture? What would you think of? Very good. So following trauma, if there is a patient presenting to you with hearing loss, you must think about petrous bone fracture. It can be a transverse fracture or it can be a longitudinal fracture. So transverse is perpendicular to the petrous bone, longitudinal is parallel. So whenever there is a petrous bone fracture, hearing loss, vertigo, facial nerve injury are the three common things, along with CSF otoria. So these are the things that you would get in a petrous bone fracture. Now the same options, but the clinical scenario is different. 70-year-old man treated with gentamicin comes 10 days later with hearing loss. What is the diagnosis? Again, he has taken a drug. What is the cause for hearing loss? What should you think about? Very good. So this situation, wherever there is a use of ototoxic medication resulting in hearing loss, you must think about ototoxicity. So the answer is G, which is ototoxicity. Very good. Same clinical situations, the scenario is different. 40-year-old lady presents with sensory neural deafness and corneal anesthesia. On and contrast enhanced MRI, ice cream cone appearance is seen in the cerebellopontine junction. What is the diagnosis? We've already discussed this image also, so this should be pretty easy for all of you. Priya, sensory neural deafness, corneal anesthesia, MRI, ice cream cone appearance. What will you think of? You already know this. Don't make silly mistakes. Very good. Now you're right. It is suggestive to you of acoustic neuroma. So in acoustic neuroma, the typical appearance is ice cream cone appearance. What is the reason for corneal anesthesia? Can you type in the chat box what is the reason for corneal anesthesia? Gobezo, I'll come to your question in just 1 second. Let's finish this and then we'll come to your question. Corneal anesthesia occurs because of what? Yes, so corneal anesthesia occurs because of the involvement of the fifth cranial nerve. So whenever there is a fifth cranial nerve involvement, it indicates that the size of tumor is at least 2.5 centimeters or more than that. Only then it can compress the fifth nerve. So the inference that you would get with the involvement of fifth nerve is the size of the tumor is more than 2.5 centimeters. So, Gobezu, gentamicin is a preferentially vestibulotoxic drug, meaning if it has to affect the hair cells, it would affect the hair cells of the vestibule preferentially than that of cochlea. But that doesn't rule out that it cannot cause cochlear hearing loss. It can cause cochlear toxicity as well. Okay? Yeah, got it, Priya? A 5-year-old boy presents with fever and is refusing to allow examination of the right ear. So, 5-year-old child not allowing you to examine. What will you think of? With fever. So, there is fever, there is pain in a 5-year-old child. So, you must think about eustachian tubal causes in a young child. So, what are the eustachian tubal disorders that can result in pain and fever? Yes, very good, Berlin, Aradhra, Ehsan Saeed. The answer is acute otitis media. So in acute otitis media, it is commonly seen in younger children, presents to you with fever and pain initially with hearing loss, and along with that the patient can have ear discharge. So, this clinical situation is suggestive of acute otitis media. 40-year-old female with hearing loss and foul-smelling scanty discharge since 2 years. Okay, I'll come to that question, Priya, 1 second. Let's finish this and then we'll come back again to that previous question. So, 40-year-old with hearing loss, foul-smelling discharge, which is scanty since 2 years. What is your diagnosis? I'm waiting for your answers. Okay, so first of all, if there is a 40-year-old female presenting to you with hearing loss and there is a foul smelling scanty discharge, if you do not have the options, would you first and foremost think about unsafe type of CSOM or a cholesteatoma? Would this be your thought process like? But this is not there in your options. But can we rule out options? Can acute otitis media result in scanty discharge, foul smelling discharge? No. Acoustic neuroma, barotrauma are no ways going to result. In BPPV, there is going to be no ear discharge, no fever, etc. Here, Mastoiditis, is it a complication that can occur following unsafe type of CSOM? Yes, so this can still be there as our one of the differential diagnosis. Otosclerosis can occur with 40-year-old female, but there is no foul smell, there is no discharge. Same with ototoxicity, petrous bone fracture. Ramsey-Hunt syndrome would present to you with vesicles in the area of distribution. So this cannot be the answer. Wax obstruction obviously will not present to you with foul smelling discharge or scanty discharge. So amongst the option given, we can only go to option E because it can be related to a complication, and in unsafe type of CSOM or cholesteatoma, we can have this sort of a complication. So we will go to this answer amongst the options given. Now the reason why I'm giving you this question is in exams they may give you purposely such questions where only by ruling out you'll be able to get to the answer. So this is how you will try to rule out the options and get to your answer. Okay, 70-year-old lady presents with a rash around the left ear with severe pain within the ear. What is the diagnosis? Now this should be very, very simple. Okay, Akanksha, Priya, say I am waiting for everyone to answer. Yes, so 70-year-old rash with severe pain is suggestive of Ramsey-Hunt syndrome, which is also called as herpes zoster otica. So it's a viral infection caused by herpes zoster virus. So this herpes zoster oticus is responsible for causing this Ramsey-Hunt syndrome. So with this, we finish our class. I hope this was useful for all of you. I have tried and incorporated various clinical situations, described you some extended matching questions just to change the monotony of single best answer type of questions and to give you a new fresh idea of how to think on different clinical scenarios with a similar option. So if you want... Okay, Priya, you wanted to discuss, this question, right? So, 5-year-old boy with fever refusing to allow examination. So, typically, whenever we talk about 5-year-old or younger children, we think about eustachian tubal causes. Now, can mastoiditis result in fever and pain in the ear? Yes. But amongst acute otitis media and mastoiditis, which one is more specifically seen in children? Acute otitis media. Mastoiditis is a complication that can occur following acute otitis media, and no such entity describing a complication has been described in your question, which is why you will still stick to acute otitis media. You're welcome, Gobizu, and I hope all of you enjoyed this, and I'll take your leave for now, and I will see you all again with my next sessions. Those interested in attending my classes can attend the free classes on Unacademy, which are called as special classes, and that is absolutely free, and paid classes are called as plus classes. So all those who are interested in plus classes may join in the plus classes as well. So take care. Good night. Bye-bye.